Yeah, you know, we're absolutely committed to supporting Windows containers. They went GA in Kubernetes 1.14 in the open source project, and most of that code, not all of that code, but a lot of that code was actually written by Microsoft. And we have Windows container support in preview in the Azure Kubernetes Service today. And obviously, people want it to be in general availability. And we're in the process of finishing up the work necessary to bring it to general availability. So we're absolutely committed to both the Windows containers in upstream Kubernetes and also Windows containers in the Azure Kubernetes Service. So Arc is a really interesting thing because what we've realized the more we talk to people is that hybrid cloud is a steady state, right? I think I used to think of it as being a waypoint. Right, you're in a data center, you're hybrid, now you're in the cloud. But what we've realized in talking to all these people is hybrid is just the way they're going to do business. Right, if you're a retailer and you have a store, we're not going to take that store and put it in our data center. Right, it's very hard for people to come in and buy things from you if your store is in the data center. And so we need to build tools that allow Azure to span from our data centers out to on-premise environments. That's what Azure Arc is for, right? So we talk to customers who say, I love using AKS, it's fantastic, in Azure. But I've got 500 stores, and there's a Kubernetes cluster in each store. What are you going to do for me there, right? And so Arc is a way of saying, look, we can actually represent that Kubernetes cluster, kind of adopt it into Azure, if you will, and start helping you manage it, tell you if you're out of date, tell you if there's a security problem. Provide monitoring for the applications that you're running there, image them to make sure that every single cluster, no matter whether it's in Azure or on-premise, looks and feels exactly the same using GitOps. So that's the promise of Arc, and I think one of the values that we want to deliver there is that it's constantly improving. So today we're going to give you some very basic management features. In 3 months more, in another 3 months even more, right? So I think we're always trying to, we would love to get to a place where the experience of AKS in Azure and the experience on-prem is identical. That's a long way off, but that's the North Star. When it comes to creating 5,000 node clusters, and honestly, with AKS in general, what we really try and do is follow the customer need, right? AKS actually used to be a lot smaller than 1,000 nodes, and we worked with some of our biggest customers to make the improvements necessary to satisfy their need for 1,000 node clusters. When you consider Azure is pushing 100 cores, more than 100 cores on its largest VMs, it's 100,000 cores across a 1,000 node cluster. It's a lot of compute. And so I think that we're always just going to focus on making sure that the customers that we have the compute that they need. And for now, that's the sweet spot for that is 1,000. I don't think we want to get into sort of numbers competitions and things like that. We'd much rather be customer driven in how we do that scaling and how we make those decisions. Yeah, this is a big issue, I think, at some level. How do you maintain an enterprise that wants to standardize on a particular version or a particular release with a community that's spitting out a new release every 3 months, right? And honestly, although I will also say I've got also some forward-looking enterprises who are on me when the new release comes out. When is it going to be out? When is it available for us? So like it's this balance of like people who want to really fix and stay, and people who really want to be on the bleeding edge. What we're working through is figuring out how do we support both of those classes of customer. How do we make sure? Because obviously we can't have 20 different versions that we support all the time. Just too many. Right? So how can we have something that's more like a long-term support version and yet also maintain the bleeding edge? That's an area that we're working on. Now, I think there's also an argument to be said for sort of adopting more of a continuous upgrade strategy, saying like maybe we can get to a place where a customer is so comfortable with our upgrades, they just turn on auto upgrades, and they're standardizing on it. Azure Kubernetes Service. They're not standardizing on Azure Kubernetes Service version 1.15.4, right? I hope that we can get people there because I feel like that's the most important way to be because you're always getting the latest security updates, latest reliability fixes. That's obviously a challenge, especially for a lot of traditional places. It can be a challenge. So I think it's a combination of building the right product but also working with them to understand how the cloud changes things, right? They're not necessarily, when they use Azure SQL and as a service, they're not necessarily as focused on what version of Azure SQL it is. Right. So I think hopefully we can get there. We have really, really good penetration into our top customers. There is a lot of interest across the board in Kubernetes and how it can change the way that they build and deploy applications. So we're really excited to partner with both the smaller companies who've come up and who maybe the very first thing that they're building is containers, as well as the large enterprises who are figuring out, how do I modernize my estate? How do I go through that digital transformation? And the truth is that you really learn a lot from both sides, and you can actually help both sides. You can take some of that, like, well, have you thought about what it's going to be like when you're trying to penetrate into the healthcare market and there's all this regulation? And you can also talk to the more incumbent, large-scale Fortune 500 companies and say, hey, have you thought about doing releases every day? What would that mean for you? So we really value customers across the spectrum. But I think that the premise of the question of when do I choose app services versus Kubernetes assumes at some level that they're separate choices. I really hope that we get to a place where you choose a programming model like app services for a particular application, and it runs on Kubernetes. And it can run next to a bare container, or it can run next to Azure Function running on Kubernetes. I think we really need to get to a place where the programming model that you choose doesn't dictate the platform that you're running on, because people want interoperability. They don't want this choice to feel like it's such a big deal. Right? They want to know that if they chose one and it turns out not to be right, it's easy to move, all that sort of stuff. I think right now these platforms, they feel like really big choices, and I want it to be a much smaller choice, much easier choice. I think that the developer experience in the Azure ecosystem has the amazing advantages of the developer history that Microsoft has. Right? I think Microsoft has a truly unique history in developer tooling and developer productivity. And when you look at things like GitHub, when you look at things like VS Code, in the Kubernetes ecosystem, when you look at things like Helm, which is a project that an open source project, but that we largely support, you're looking at just a suite of tools that people are using no matter where they're using Kubernetes. And so then to know that those things are going to be well integrated with the Azure Kubernetes Service, are going to be built by the same people who are using the Azure Kubernetes Service, you just have that confidence that the end-to-end flow from your code in GitHub all the way through to your container running out in Azure is just going to be a seamless experience organized around, you know, your productivity as a developer. I think that's truly unique and honestly the most exciting reason why I'm here. We use GitOps in the Azure for the Arc service, as I said. And when people are talking about GitOps, it's sort of a logical extension of infrastructure as code. So when you were doing infrastructure as code, you're writing down a description of your infrastructure. Well, if you write something down, you need some place to put it. Well, the place where we put text files in general is version control. And when we think about version control, that's Git, and usually GitHub. Then GitOps was basically an extension of that to say, well, you're pushing the configuration into Git. Why not automatically then apply that configuration out to a cluster? So it's continuous delivery of that configuration, making it just like a platform as a service might have a push to deploy model for code. GitOps is saying, hey, we're going to have a Git push, validate in GitHub actions, and then deploy out to your cluster. So I actually think it's a great model. You know, we have to get the right kind of testing and the right kind of validation right, so you don't take out your production environment with one Git push. But I think that it's just another iteration on an evolution on the idea of infrastructure as code.